The Tao Te Ching is a book of wisdom poetry written in China about 2,600 years ago. It's comprised of 81 short chapters written by a Chinese sage named Lao-tzu. The title actually means the book of the way of natural power or natural virtue. Ching means book. Tao means the way or the path or the natural flow of life. And Ti De means power or virtue that is inherent in all living beings, in fact, in all matter of the universe. So it's a book of wisdom poetry that is exploring the idea of the way of natural power. The activist Tao Te Ching is my own personal expression of the wisdom contained in the Tao Te Ching, expressed especially for activists in today's world. I've taken the same 81 chapters and digested, I hope, and internalized the themes of those chapters, then expressed them again in my own poetry and my own short prose in an attempt to communicate what I feel is so important from the Tao Te Ching to all of those people, all of us people, who are involved in trying to do something in today's world. It's the wisdom of the Tao Te Ching, I hope, presented in my own poetry and prose for the activist. There are several countercultural elements to a Taoist approach to revolution and activism. The first is a sense of a mistrust of propaganda or words, or flowery speeches or eloquent expressions. Lao Tzu felt that words narrowed and confined ideas. They were necessary, but they were always dangerous to use. One of his famous passages is, "Those who know don't talk. Those who talk don't really know." And the Tao that can be spoken or written is not really the Tao, the way things naturally go. The minute you write it down or say it, that's not quite it. So a Taoist approach to revolution avoids flowery speeches and avoids the pretense that we really know what we're talking about. We're just doing what we do. Another element is that leaders should be unseen, unnoticed. Rather than out at the front of a march or out at the head of an organization or a movement, leaders should be the one who are unnoticed in the back, bringing water from the wells to the people who are actually doing the work. When the best leader does his or her job, the people are able to say, "Look what we did all by ourselves," and they'll be right, because the leader would have been just the person who's encouraging and equipping and helping and enabling. Another countercultural element is the sense of fluidity and flow. Lao Tzu often used water as a metaphor, as it flows to the ocean regardless of the obstacles that are put in its way. When it meets an obstacle, it will either seep under, it'll carve a way around, it'll flood over, or it will just evaporate and rain on the other side. He said that our actions should be like water, so that when we flow up against an obstacle, instead of meeting it head on and trying to overcome it, which may on rare occasions work, we look for ways of going around, over, under, or raining on the other side. Another countercultural element is the sense of effortless doing, very counter to our way of doing things in our culture. It's not a caricature of Taoism that sits back and goes with the flow. It's a sense of effortless doing, a sense of doing our actions without one foot on the gas and one foot on the brake, without second thoughts, without reservations, without wondering, without attachments to outcome, but just doing what we do while we're doing it, because we do it. And then when we rest, we just rest completely. We give everything up and renew ourselves and go back to the quiet. And then when action arises, we just do it naturally. There's no self-conscious effort. It's as if the activism is doing itself. We're not the ones who are doing it. And a final countercultural element to Taoist revolution that seems to me is the deep conviction that we belong to something much greater than anything we can imagine. That we literally are the stuff of the stars doing the work of stars in the universe. As Carl Sagan said, we're the stuff of stars looking back at the stars. It's a mystical sense of being part of a revolution that we didn't start and that we're not going to finish and that we have no real attachments to, but we're part of this stream that's unstoppable. It's not our stream. We're merely a part of it and we belong to it. And our revolution grows out of that rather than something we're self-consciously trying to do. I've studied and worked with the Tao Te Ching most of my life and always appreciated its serenity, its acceptance, its flexibility. But I've tended to overlook the activist element that's an essential part of it. There's an activism that grows out of the quietism of the Tao Te Ching, and in my own life I'm beginning to notice that. Out of the quiet and out of the acceptance and out of the flexibility, I begin to see action arising, not out of obligation and not out of guilt or not out of duty, but just because it seems to be the thing to do. I also notice multiple tipping points in my society and my culture. Anyone would notice these tipping points. The climate has tipped and in many ways can't go back to what it used to be, and it's primarily our responsibility. Culture is tipping. Injustice is growing. The gap between the rich and the poor has reached a tipping point that can't go back to the way things always are. All of our institutions have reached tipping points and will no longer work. In a society of multiple personal and cultural tipping points, there's a more important role than ever for the quietest activist, the quiet revolutionary. There are so many people in the world today who are frustrated and angry and sad and discouraged at the state of things, and we want to do something, and yet we feel exhausted and inconsequential and ineffective. I wrote the book to speak to those feelings and to those needs.